Seership.
Whoa.
Mysterious Seership. I have to go out in the moonlight, wear robes of silver. Not really. Seership. Well, Seership is a form of leadership. Seership encompasses really a whole array of disciplines, from channeling to scrying to psychometry, even to some degree healing could be a sort of a form of seership in some ways. Prophecy is a form of seership, being able to scan through time. So, yes, seership is really about the gifts to perceive beyond the illusion of three-dimensional separateness and to perceive beyond the limitations of being a separate self. And it is often about communication between different planes, as in with channeling, where you receive certain knowing from a different plane, usually a higher plane if you do it in the service of love, although you can channel just about anything. You can channel fear, you can channel darkness, you can channel attack energy. But if you want to do to be a seer in the service of evolution, in the service of the divine plan, then what you will channel will be from higher dimensions of love and truth, and in a way that is in alignment with evolution and the greater good of all concerned. And seership is a form of leadership because it is literally a power. And we talk about magical powers, and you know, often it's romanticized around the old magicians and the ancient priests and priestesses of different traditions having powers, magical powers to see the future or to bring messages from God, etc., etc. And they are powers, they are gifts, but not in terms of a power that makes you better than anyone else. They are powers because they exert an influence over others, the recipient of your channeling or the message that you give, or even if you tell someone about the future, straight away it gives you power over them because it's likely to shape their choices and the decisions that they make. Knowing what might happen in the future, that changes everything. So with that kind of power, with that kind of knowing and knowledge comes responsibility. And so seership is responsibility and it is leadership. And anyone who wants to be a leader in the world of men, whether it's in politics or science or the arts or any endeavor really where you want to be a leader, which means to be at the forefront of a movement and being at the head of that movement, leading it in a particular direction. If you want to do that in a way that's in harmony with evolution, with a higher purpose, you need to have a certain amount of seership abilities there, because without those seership abilities, you can't really communicate with guiding intelligences on a higher level in order to take instructions and to make sure that you follow the flow of divine will from higher level. A leader who is a wise leader, who is an enlightened leader, is always a leader who will partner with the Universal Mother, who will partner with the forces of evolution in order to conduct their mission, their work, their project in a way that is in alignment with divine plan and purpose, with divine will. And the ability to communicate with those higher intelligences, with the forces of evolution, is partly what seership is about, or mostly what seership is about. That's the real essence of it. And so it's really all about communication and being able to bridge the higher and the lower, the inner and the outer. And it is a form of leadership just from doing that, when the vast majority of people on this planet are not able to do that, because either they have shut down those gifts, or they have not yet actualized their potential to the level where they're able to even connect with those energies, or because they are caught up in the illusion of separation that is so rampant in this world. So it is something which has an effect on the world. And like everything in life, whatever choice you make, whatever words you speak, whatever thoughts you think, whatever energy you put out there in the world will have a consequence, will have an effect. And you are responsible for that effect. So seership is not something to be taken lightly. It's not about going out there and hanging out a shingle, professing yourself to be the great prophecy or fortune teller of the century, and then doing it just as a way to make money, because everything you're going to say to those people, all the guidance you're going to give them is really is going to have an effect on them. And to some degree, if that throws them on a tangent which causes them to go into fear or to diverge of the path that they were supposed to follow, if you do that without really making sure that your channeling is clear, is coming from a place of serving the forces evolution, it's not about you, it's not about making money, it's not about personal profit, it's not about selfish motives, then if you don't have that, then you can really cause a lot of harm and be karmically responsible for that to some degree. So, you know, it's not to scare you away from seership, but it is not something to be taken lightly. It's not a game, and it's not about a glamorous thing to make yourself look or feel important in the eyes of others. It is a form of leadership, and it has a lot of responsibility entailed to it. And with that comes a very strong duty of care towards those who are the recipient of whatever your seership causes you to say or do or direct towards. Now, as I said before, seership can be a tune and a line to just about anything. If you're a soul that's more working on the dark path, which is more the path of personal power and ego and fear and power over, then you will tend to use your seership to work with lower level energies, energies of fear, energies that are over, that are all about power over and maintaining fear on this planet. And if this is a path that you've been on in the past, you have to be very careful that when you really realign to a path of love and start to really develop your seership abilities again, you don't go back into old habits of doing it in the old ways that you used to do on the dark path, which was, you know, the old alignments that you had in terms of receiving communications from the darker energies, or even the astral plane, being attuned to the astral plane. There's a lot of fortune tellers and, you know, soothsayers, etc. out there that work with the astral plane, you know, pass on messages from the dead and so on. And, you know, there's nothing wrong with that. That's fine. But we have to be very aware that we here at the Cosmosis Mentoring Center do not support communicating with the astral plane, simply because the astral plane is the plane just above the physical plane, and it's a very emotional plane. It's not a plane of clarity. There's a lot of fear, there's a lot of distortion, there's a lot of darkness still on that plane. There's also some souls hanging on that level that can be loving and lovely, but that's where all the souls that have recently died go while they work out through some of their issues. Sometimes that's where they stay for a while they're still in shock and haven't quite realized that they've died. Or for the souls that are not quite willing to let go of this life for whatever reason, they're really attached, or they stuck in some revenge pattern about someone who's still alive or whatever, they can stay on the astral plane for much longer than they need to. And so, you know, it's not because someone dies that they suddenly have all the answers and are enlightened and know everything about everything. You know, they're just like us, except they don't have a body. So there's not really much enlightenment to be gained from communicating with the astral plane. It's just like talking to a bunch of other people. You can just go out to the shopping center and gather everyone and talk to them, and you get about the same amount of enlightenment that you would get from the souls on the astral plane. So we don't really advise that. You know, there's nothing wrong with sometimes just, you know, if a loved one has just passed away, you know, and they sometimes hang around for a bit. You know, sometimes they like to come to the funeral, etc., to just, you know, have a chat with them, so that can happen. But it's not something you want to keep doing over time, and also because you want to allow those souls to continue on their journey. If a soul that dies and transitions and goes correctly through the process, they'll only be stuck on the astral plane for a period of time while they work through detaching from the body and dismantling their astral body and working through some emotional issues, etc., etc., for a while they work through some of their issues and process and letting go. And then hopefully then they'll continue and then move on to the mental plane, etc., etc. So, yeah, we don't advise using your seership abilities to communicate with the astral plane as an ongoing thing. It's really not you know, it's just too dangerous in terms of what you can find there. Certain souls can pose as very nice people, but they have ulterior motives. It's just, it's a bit of a dirty area, really, you don't want to mingle with. So make sure that you really attuned and aligned to something much higher than that. With seership, seership is really a receptive thing. It's a feminine, more feminine quality. Of course, nothing's ever completely feminine or masculine. So there needs to be a certain amount of masculine qualities when you practice seership in terms of staying strong, in holding a sacred space, being aligned in yourself, being centered, being plugged in to higher intelligences and beings of love and truth. And so there needs to be a certain strength and assertiveness and courage in holding that steady and holding that sacred space and being protective of that sacred space, because as everything that is really sacred, it needs to be surrounded by a strong protective boundary so that anything less than unconditional love cannot come into the space, so the space remains sacred rather than be polluted by any sort of fear that may be around in the environment. But for the most part, channeling is about receiving. And it's about receiving communications, it's about receiving energy. All communication is energy. And when one channels, it can be without words. However, it is often useful to add words to a channeling simply because it helps the other person kind of open up and have a cup to put the knowing that is being transmitted energetically in. But the real essence of channeling is energy. Everything is energy. The real essence of everything in life is energy. You know, any feelings that you will have, you can put words to it, but the real essence of the experience of that feeling will be in feeling the feeling. Feeling, actually experiencing the energy and the impact that this energy has on your human vehicle. And you can talk about it all you want. As long as you feel it, you won't really have integrated and experienced what that energy is about and what it has to teach you. So channeling is really about receiving energy, but then it's also about bridging the higher and the lower. And a seer, you know, in some of the old traditions, especially like the Celtic traditions, there's often a talk of the seers being the ones that walk between the worlds. They have a foot in each world and they pass through the veils back and forth between the veils of the world. And it is really about being this bridge between different dimensions, different worlds, and having a foot in each world, so to speak, and being a channel between the two, being a bridge between the two, whether you channel healing energy as a healer or channel a message, guidance when you do readings, or whether you actually step beyond the veil of that illusion of linear time and just perceive the potential futures of what happened and work with more like the matrix of time with prophecy. Whatever it is a bit of using your connections and your ability to tune in to certain energies and actually plug in and communicate with certain energies, intelligences that are on these other planes and dimensions of existence in order to bring that back into this dimension so it can be of use to evolution, to the people that you are serving, or for yourself if you are channeling for yourself or feeling into potential futures for yourself. And so it is very much about bridging a lot of different things. And an important aspect of developing seership is about working on transcending the illusion of ego identification. If you think that you are no more than this body and the mind that's attached to it, the monkey mind, then you will have trouble with seership, because seership is about getting that out of the way. Because the body, the mind, is fully identified with being this thing in this dimension, in this world, and nothing else. So you have to really expand your sense of self and your sense of identification to something much beyond that, realizing that you yourself are a multidimensional being, in order to then be able to plug into other dimensions. You can only plug into something that you're able to connect with. And if you're completely caught up in being a little separate ego with its little monkey mind that goes round and round in circle inside itself, you're not going to be able to surrender to being the multi-dimensional being that you are, who's able to then plug into things on these other dimensions that, you know, you are able to touch into. So to be a good seer, you need to work on yourself. You need to clear yourself psychologically. You need to clear your fears. You need to transcend the sense of separate identity as being who you really are, and just awaken to being actually the indwelling spirit energy and presence that is anchored in this body. You need to really expand your awareness. You need to be able to get the separate self out of the way, because the separate self will always tend to get in the way of seership, whether it's about scrying or channeling or prophecy or healing. As long as if the ego is there and is in the way, or even is in the driver's seat in that moment, well, first of all, you'll have trouble connecting and holding the space. But the ego can throw all sorts of things into the energy that's being brought through and taint that energy. It's just like you're trying to bring some really clear, pure water from up the mountain, and you really just extend a pipe to go all the way to the mountain and get that beautiful, clear energy. But when it gets close to the village, you get all the idiots of the village to start pooing in the stream and doing all these things. By the time the water gets to the villages, it's going to be disgusting and minging. And that's what your monkey mind and your ego, and not exactly the most charming metaphor, but it is really how it is. And that's what the negative ego and your monkey mind can do if you don't just get it out of the way and just be fully as spirit, in spirit, a multidimensional being that's just linking to other dimension of your being and inviting greater intelligences and being to then communicate with you and through you in order to perform a service to humanity or your clients, then you're going to have trouble. And as everything, if you let that happen, you let your ego run rampant, you project your own slants and your own little opinions and your own issues into the mix, the effect that it's going to have with that dirty, muddy water, stinky water, is not going to be what that clear water was supposed to do. And whatever mess that makes, once again, you are karmically responsible for. So, leadership and seership, walking between the world, completely and intimately link with your process of personal growth. Psychological clarity, which means that you actually clear your psyche of issues, including unconscious issues. A lot of the psychological process is about making issues that are unconscious conscious, so you can clear them and have your psyche function in a way that is about love and wisdom and harmony and unity, rather than it throwing little weapons of fear and sabotage patterns and things in there where you're trying to do something but your unconscious issue just get in the way and distort everything you're trying to do, you know. And I'm sure we've all experienced that and met other people who have the best of intentions, or you have the best of intentions, but somehow it all comes out wrong and never, you know, brings in the effects that you expect or you want. That's because you're getting really hijacked by all these unconscious stuff that keeps coming in the way and distorting the energy that you're transmitting out and sabotaging what you're trying to do, whether you're conscious of it or not. So that needs to be the other side of the coin with the seership process. The clearer you are, the more you're able to be a clear channel, the clear healer, a clear prophesier, prophet, but prophet has a whole different kind of slant now these days. So, you know, being a master is about loving the self yet being selfless. Being a seer has a lot to do with that as well. It's about allowing yourself to know that you can do it, that you have the ability, and sure, you might need to develop some of the skills, you might need to reignite some of those abilities and strengthen them. So practice is a real key element of seership, practicing a lot. So you need to love yourself and be a good inner coach of yourself. Yes, I can do it, and have a go. Don't be afraid to make a mistake, because if you stay stuck in a sense of, oh my God, you know, I don't want to get it wrong, I don't want my mind to get in the way, I don't want my ego to get in the way, then you get caught up in so much fear. That's ego, just as much as, you know, being all self-righteous is ego. Being caught up in fear and self-consciousness and doubting yourself all the time is also ego. And if you let that get in the way, then your channelings are usually not going to flow very well, but they also potentially could get tainted by that fear and that doubt. So certainly clearing the ego and being able to love the self and have that confidence, but not going into self-righteousness, not going into being overconfident and letting the ego then get in the way and thinking that it knows what spirit's talking about, you know. And that's always the danger when you have an ego that's very good at posing as being spiritual. It says all the right thing, but the energy is still really about fear and self-preservation and being better than, etc. But all the words and the thoughts it projects, you know, are very lovely, but the energy behind it, you know, you can feel when someone has really transcended the control of their ego and the identification with ego, and they speak on spiritual matters, you know, however it sounds, the energy feels very clear, and it's not about impressing anyone, it's not about being better than, it's not about putting themselves on a pedestal, and it's loving, even though it can be the tough love hammer, because love can sometimes be very confronting to the fears that we hold within ourselves. But at the same time, someone who is in ego and has their ego being very good at faking to be spiritual, they will tend to say all the right thing and behave really sweetly and very nicely. But you can feel, if you're honest with yourself and if you've been working with this kind of material and on this path for a while, and you really want to know the truth and look behind appearances, behind the behavior and the words and even the thoughts they might project to the essence of what you're really feeling from them, what you will feel is still an ego. That's something that's about personal power, about me being powerful, me being empowered, which is not the same thing as letting a greater power flow through you and surrendering to something greater. There won't be the same kind of aura about those people, you know, and you got to be careful, because some people are very good at projecting a glamour. And it's like, ooh, glittery, and there's something really, ooh, ah, you know, gives you the, ooh, the fuzzies. But that's not necessarily the same as someone who actually has a presence. So you can feel there's something greater moving through them than just that little person. So you got to be very discerning with that. Loving the self yet being selfless in the terms of seership is about allowing yourself to have a go, allowing yourself to get the small self, the ego, with all its fears and all its self-righteousness and all its things trying to limit you out of the way, and love yourself enough to remember that you are so much more than that, yet be selfless in terms of the seership is not about you, it's about the service that you provide through that. And really in terms of surrendering, where you surrender to your greater beingness and identity, which is the selfless self, which is the greater being that you are. And, you know, anyone who seriously is committed to achieving high level of self-mastery needs at some point to embrace seership as part of that training. Because like I said before, you cannot truly be in service to all that is without being able to communicate with all that is and bridge that inner and outer planes. So it is a must. Lots of fine lines, lots of traps in leadership, and we've talked about many of them on other videos, and we'll talk more about that. A lot of it having to do with getting the small self out of the way, a lot of it having to do with not thinking about it, getting the monkey mind out of the way, a lot having to do about it being able to hold the correct space, like I said, being strongly aligned. That's an assertive thing, that's more a masculine thing. And centered and being very protective of that sacred space that you're holding for yourself and maybe for the other person. If you're doing a healing on someone or reading for someone, you need to really hold them in that sacred space as well, so there can be that communication and exchange of whatever is being channeled. So all of that is the more masculine, assertive aspect of the process. The more feminine is all that actually surrendering to being more than just that little self. And just getting out of your own way, letting the energy, allowing, surrendering, allowing it all to flow through you, letting that energy access from your mental body the words and terms of references and metaphors that it might need to, in order to speak words, to try to provide a cup to put it in for the person that's receiving the message. But it's not the same as thinking about what you're going to say, and that's something I mentioned just before. Thinking about what you're going to say, it's like, what am I going to say this? Oh, I don't know if I should say that. Maybe I should soften it and make it more like this. And there's lots of nya going on up there when you're doing that. It's really just more in the moment. Oh, things come and it's like, this word, you don't even have to think about it. It's a flow in the moment, you know, and all of us in different moments of the day, we just speak without having to think about what we're saying. Well, most people, some people have trouble with that. You don't censor with your mind when you're channeling. You can't do that if you have masks and false identity that you're always hiding behind, because that means that whatever you're saying, however you're being, you're always controlling that with through the lenses of, oh, does that fit within this mask I like to present the world and hide behind? Or does that fit within that false identity that I'm hanging on to because I'm too scared to be who I really am in the world for whatever reason? So all of that's got to go, at least momentarily while you do the channeling. But really, if you're committed to mastery all the time, that has to be gone, period. And a lot of surrendering and nurturing and love within that, because seership is that receptive process. And, you know, you had a lot of the oracles in Delphi used to be women. You know, you had a very strong kind of seer tradition in the Celtic traditions, whether it was the Druids or the more kind of Wiccan goddess-oriented thing. But, you know, even the Druidry is quite a female kind of oriented spiritual tradition. And there needs to be a lot of love and nurture brought in with that, because it's all about bringing change and nurturing change. So there needs to be a lot of strength in terms of protecting the nurturing, loving, transformational space for the other person that you're working with or the group that you are working with. But at the same time, inside of this space, there needs to be a lot of nurture to nurture the growth of whoever or whatever you are channeling for. And it's very much the same in leadership. You know, leadership is a more first-rate quality. It's a more masculine quality, because it needs to be really a standing strong, aligned, centered, being at the forefront, providing movement forward, leading, you know, being at the head of the movement, leading it forward, pushing usually into new areas, being strong in your integrity, knowing what you're about, you know, making things happen, bang, bang, bang. Leadership has a lot of first-rate quality with it. But when you're a leader of a group, a leader of a project, as much as there is that really a lot of that first ray presence and quality to it, within that space there needs to be the ability to nurture and feed with love whatever it is that you're growing, whether it's a project or it's a group of people or the planet. So there's always a balance of these two energies in play. Any questions?
Yes, so can you talk a bit about the difference between censoring yourself and attuning into the right language and the right effect that you feel the person will be able to hear the message most clearly?
Yep.
With?
Yep. Okay, so once again, it's very much about the space that you're holding when you're doing it. Yep. When you're doing a censoring yourself, it's about the little ego, because the monkey mind is an aspect of the ego,
yes,
getting in the way of the communication because it thinks that that's too scary to say, this is too confronting, or this is too soft, or,
yeah,
oh, this person should know that, or it usually comes in with some judgment. So when the message comes, the mind gets involved in trying to work out the best way to say it in a way that the ego will be comfortable with. And usually when you do that, you won't feel yourself really plugged in, expanded into that state of being that sacred space that you need to hold.
Yeah.
And you will tend to find that there is, more mental activity. So, you know, some of it will be actually building awareness of the level of activity in your mental body.
Yeah.
Like, for instance, right now I'm channeling, but I'm not thinking.
Yeah.
You know? So, you know, only sometimes, like, I'm like, oh, I can't find the word that I'm looking for, huh?
Yeah.
And sometimes it's just, but even then I don't think, it's just, it takes me a little bit to find the word that I'm looking for. So it's almost like the mind, you know, that I've been training for a while to do this. It's kind of like a dog bringing, oh, is this the toy you want? No, that one doesn't. Is this the ball you want? No, bring that one. Oh, yeah, that's the one I need. And then you go like this. But it's really not, the ego's out of the way then. And you can really feel that in the presence that you're holding and how you feel plugged in and the energy still flowing. You know, in any channeling, you always have moments where, like, there's a stream of energy running, and blah, 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 you're sharing of that and you're feeling the energy flow, and all of a sudden it's like, that stream is finished, and then you have a bit of a, ooh, in between until the next stream comes in, where sometimes it's about you start talking about a different theme or you're going on a different directions. Sometimes you find yourself with several streams of energy coming in where you could start going on this tangent or this one or this one, and you almost have to either pick one and then go to the others, or just pick one, the others have to fall away. That happens as well. But it's a very much like a feeling, sensing kind of process, where there is no mental activity. And if you're aware of your body, you know, there's not a voice in there talking, trying to think, oh, like little Charlie just thinking, how do I say this? You know, there's none of that. It's just more like a this word, kind of like that. It's hard to explain because it's such a feeling kind of experience.
Yeah.
But, you know, signs that you are not doing that will be generally the energy will not really flow. You won't feel as plugged in. You won't feel as present. You won't feel as expanded. You'll pick up more activity in your mental body. Some of it is practice. Like I said, the more you practice, the more you'll get better at translating without having to think about it. And you know, sometimes when you first start, you get into a channeling space and the energy's there, it's flowing, but you don't know how to talk along with that, you know. And the more you practice, the more you start to, basically it's a bit like describing what you're feeling. It's a good way to start. So, you know, oh, I'm feeling, you know, there's this real expansion going towards you, but you're resisting. And so you start a bit describing what it is that you're feeling is moving through you. And that, you know, and then you start to get better at tempering that with at the same time feeling and sensing what's going on in the other person.
Yeah.
You know, you actually start to pick up, oh, you have an issue with this, and you have a feelings around that, and I can feel there's something really close down there. And it starts to all blend in a dance that the mind cannot possibly keep track of. And if the mind starts to get in the way, you'll start, it can't take in so many streams of knowing and information all at once, and it's just going to get in the way, and you're just going to get lost and confused, and you're going to lose it, basically.
Yeah. But if you feel like you're flowing and working with the other person, and they're resisting to a point, or they're kind of, they're not getting the metaphor clearly,
yeah,
in the way that they're not really digesting the core essence of the message,
uh-huh,
in a way.
Yeah.
Well,
once again, it really depends. You'd have to feel in the moment, because
yeah,
every instance can be slightly different.
Yeah.
Sometimes there are things like that in the moment, they're like, their mind doesn't get it. But if they're receiving the energy, then let them go away with that and something will happen,
okay,
when
right,
it's the right time.
Yeah.
You know? Sometimes you need to actually sense more into the person, and without getting caught up in their reality, sense more where they're coming from and try to access some things that are going to be more along the lines of where they're coming from.
Yeah.
You know, like you're talking to someone who's a truck driver and you've just used a metaphor about motherhood.
Yeah.
And they're like, what the fuck? You know, so you just kind of feel into them, and more you use a metaphor, it's going to be more relevant to where they're coming from, their reality, for instance. And sometimes just, you know, where they're really not getting it. If the mind doesn't get it, in a way, it doesn't really matter. As long as they're receiving the energy, that's the real essence of the channeling, is them actually being receptive to the energy and being open to the energy.
Okay.
Now, if they're not and they're closing down to that, then perhaps try to, you know, trying to force it onto them is likely to cause them to close up more.
Yeah.
So, you know, just try, you know, just maybe let upstairs know, it's like, well, this person's really not receptive. And they might just, upstairs might then modulate the energy, because you're giving them feedback about what's happening.
Right.
And they might then modulate the energy to be more, you know, in the flavor that the other person's likely to receive.
Yeah.
If they're still not, you know, sometimes there's nothing you can do, you know.
Yeah.
They come, but maybe they didn't really want to, or maybe they're there to kind of, you know, prove that you can't do it. Or,
yeah,
you know, some people come there because their wife wanted them to come, and they're there, but they really don't want to be there, and they're not going to receive anything you're giving. And, you know, just to prove you wrong kind of thing. When it's like this, you can't really do anything, you know. But upstairs will just guide you to whatever it is. And sometimes you feel someone's not got it, that they haven't received anything. And then they come back a few months later and go, wow, actually, you know, after the fact, it really changed something in me.
Mm-hmm.
So you can't second guess. You just got to trust the energy. If there's something that seems really not right, you can try to adapt how you're translating a bit, without thinking. It's a very organic, intuitive process. It's a dance in the moment, and you would kind of understand that from acting. If you had to, something went wrong, you had to improvise. You can't start thinking and go, hold on, I got to think about a way to do it. You got to take it in the moment and dance with that, you know. It's the same with music. There's a lot of activities like this where you just don't have time to think. You have to intuitively just feel your way through. So you can do that, but if that's still not working, you just let upstairs know this person doesn't seem to be responsive, but you just let upstairs do what they do, because in the end they know much better than you will ever know. They just get a whole different perspective. They know that person, because when you work with someone, you always need to involve their guides and their spirit mentors. So they know that person much better than you do, and so on. You may feel that you're getting nowhere, but if upstairs feel that it's still worth continuing, then do that. But sometimes you may get a sense of, okay, there's no point, just shut down, stop it, you know, and then you got to go with what upstairs says with that. And if they paid you for a session, you might need to reimburse them and do that.
Yeah, great. Thank you.
Nice. Any other questions or sharing? Oh, yeah, sure.
Above your understanding of...
Sure. Sure. But in the moment, and I'm channeling it, it's like, it makes perfect sense. And then after the fact, then it kind of like, oh, now I know that kind of thing. Now I'm able to access that. I've seen it. So, certainly. But, you know, it's not about what you know. It's being able to access. It's like, you can know, you don't know anything, but you can know everything. You just have to plug in and just download that knowing. But for that, you have to get out of your own way. You have to let go of your preconceptions, your beliefs, your self-doubt, etc., etc. And just, you know, your attachments. If you want the truth to be a particular way and you're trying to plug in, yes, I want the truth as long as it fits in within what I'm comfortable with the truth to be, then you're not going to get some clear information, of course. But you can tune in just in about anything. And a lot of the blocks to that is about opening your mind, you know, just letting go of what you think you can and can't do, what you think you're capable, not capable of, what you think you know, don't know, or have to know, not know. Just let it all go and just allow yourself to feel into your infinite abilities and your infinite potentials.
Yeah.